thank you all for coming. I'm really excited to have Professor Takanuma over here. I want to thank the Women's Law Association, the Tax Law and Financial Regulation Student Association, and the Modern Money Network for making this event happen. Just a really brief introduction. Professor Hockett is Professor Hockett and Professor Omarova are both at Cornell Law School. Professor Hockett was previously at the IMF, Federal Reserve, and so when you talk about rethinking finance, he sort of has been in that world and knows it very well. Same with Professor Omarova. Prior to entering academia, she was at Davis Polk and at the Treasury Department doing regulatory advisory type role. Yeah. Okay, so with that, I'll hand it over to them.
Well, thanks so much, guys. It really is a joy and an honor to be here and have a chance to talk to you guys. So we thought what we would do is maybe just make a few remarks each about the nature of our work, sort of what prompts it, what motivates it, what its fundamental sort of conceptual presuppositions and apparatus are, and what sort of tentative or provisional normative conclusions we draw from the work, and what kind of institutional proposals we think are sort of called for, given the sort of normative consequences of that work. So we'll sort of lay it out in that way, again, relatively briefly, and then we thought it might be much more interesting and fun to have an actual discussion or conversation about it. So I'll kick it off and then hand it over to Sally. One way I think maybe of looking at our work is look at it sort of in terms of what has occasioned it. Both of us, of course, looked at the crisis that sort of emerged in 2008 as a sort of milestone. In that respect, we're hardly unique or even unusual. I think everybody viewed 2008 and what happened afterwards as a kind of milestone, and it's kind of indicative that something has gone kind of wrong. And then the question is, well, what precisely has gone wrong, or how many different things might have gone wrong? And we think maybe one way of diagnosing the problem, one way of understanding what happened in 2008 and what's been happening since, is that it's in effect the kind of ultimate consequence of a fundamental error in thinking that we have all been making in connection with finance and with banking over the last half century at least, and maybe longer. The error is to think of finance and financial markets and banks and even markets more generally as matters of sort of pure private ordering, where lots of individuals come together and they transact in various ways. And in the financial markets in particular, you've got people who oftentimes are referred to in these sort of vapid textbooks as surplus units, people who have extra pre-accumulated funds or capital of one kind or another. And then you've got other people on the other side who are called deficit units, who are short of capital, who don't have any capital to work with. And the fundamental function of the financial system is to bring these two classes of people together, enable the surplus units to sort of send their financing over toward the deficit units, and to do so for a return, some sort of profit, whether it be in the nature of interest payments or in the nature of equity stakes or what have you. Then the role that the public sector is viewed as having or taking in a case like this is as a kind of exogenously acting, occasionally intervening, outside actor, right? So a government or the public sector in the form of its government or its various government instrumentalities comes in from time to time to sort of put things right. It also, of course, enforces various rules of the game that are thought necessary in order for the game actually to proceed in a functional manner. But basically, it's a kind of a variation on the old night watchman state idea. Occasionally, you find a slightly deeper treatment of the state where you view the state as being, at least in some sense, constitutive of the markets, in the sense that the various bodies of law, including so-called private law, as distinguished from public law or regulatory law, are viewed as sort of necessary prerequisites for market ordering at all, and so the state, at the very least, sort of supplies that kind of underlying foundational set of private law principles on the basis of which then private ordering proceeds. And then, once that's all sort of, it's kind of like the divine watchmaker idea of Isaac Newton. It's kind of set everything in motion now. It can just kind of sit back and watch all of the miracles of private ordering and of the markets proceed. And again, just occasionally intervene to kind of set things right if something goes wrong. Now, in our view, that is just a fundamentally misconceived idea, at least where the financial system is concerned, probably where markets as a whole or in general are concerned, but especially in the case of financial markets. And there are a number of ways in which to sort of describe the sense in which we view this as being wrong, but maybe the easiest way or the easiest focus is just to note that the entire system runs on, the entire financial system is grounded in or based upon two kinds of security in particular, two kinds of financial instrument, as you might call it, in particular. One is, of course, the currency, right? And the other is the treasury securities, right? The public debt instruments that are issued by the public sector. It's fascinating, if you think about it, that the public debt securities, the U.S. treasuries here in the U.S., are essentially, I mean, these sort of the completely indispensable element in the financial markets. Indeed, there's been all sorts of interesting research that indicates that treasury securities have constituted a constant fraction of total market capitalization over the last 70 to 80 years at least. That's notwithstanding the fact that the financial markets have become bigger and bigger and bigger. In other words, the total market cap has grown astronomically and steadily over the course of those years. But all throughout, U.S. treasuries are a constant fraction of that. So they have grown as that larger market has grown. It turns out, and we think it can be shown, that that's no accident. That's one kind of instrument, and that's the instrument on which the financial markets depend. The other instrument is a kind of counterpart. It's the central banking counterparts to the treasuries and securities, and that's just dollars here in the U.S. This is just the currency. Indeed, you pull out a dollar bill. A friend of ours is a shtick. We'll always say, pull out a dollar bill or a $5 bill. You pull it out, you look across the top. It's this Federal Reserve note. It's essentially a claim that's issued by the central bank. And if you hold that, you have a claim in the same way that you have a claim if you have a treasury security. And both of these can be thought of as kinds of money. Both are essentially the liquidity reservoirs of particular segments of the financial system. The next sense in which one can sort of, the next hint, I suppose you might say, that the picture that we think is wrong, the picture of the financial system that we think is wrong, is by looking at the role that the central bank in particular plays, or if you want to be a little more generic, that the public sector plays in constituting the financial system, even apart from its particular instruments, financial instruments. So if you look at how lending occurs, if you look at how credit is actually generated in any modern economy, again, the typical presupposition is that, well, credit is only basically, it's a matter of people who have it, again, these surplus units who hold pre-accumulated capital on the one hand, and then these deficit units who need it on the other, and the financial system brings them together. So it's all of these private sector surplus units who are effectively extending the credit. That's completely false. If you start with the banking core of any financial system, you'll see right away, that essentially what goes on in the banking sector is banks extend credit. They're not reliant in any way on antecedently accumulated funds, in other words, on deposits that have been put into them by private depositors in order to engage in that lending activity. In fact, what happens is when banks extend loans, those loans are immediately recognized as long as, again, the bank is operating within the regulatory frame that it's meant, that it's expected to act within. Those loans are immediately recognized by the central bank, by the Fed here in the States, and they are quote-unquote accommodated, which is to say that once I've taken out a loan from my bank and the bank has given me the loan in the form of either opening a deposit account in my name or crediting an already opened deposit account that's already in my name, if I start writing checks on or using a bank card that is associated with that account that has been opened for me or otherwise credited to me, I can start making payments of this sort immediately, and those are all recognized by the Fed. They are what we call, in the business, accommodated. And if you think about it, it's very clear why that would be the case. If the Fed didn't do this, so that any possible payee in the transaction had to worry that, oh, this person might not be good for the claim that he or she is conveying to me in the form of this check or this black bank card swipe, the entire payment system would melt down and fall apart, and we wouldn't have any sort of market transacting at all. So the central bank in any modern jurisdiction effectively accommodates these kinds of transactions that are all rooted in credit that is extended by banks, credit which is in no way dependent on antecedently accumulated deposits. And what this ultimately means, if you think about it, the best interpretation to put on the way this sort of transacting works is to say that what's going on here is that the full faith and credit of the United States is a kind of resource that is being essentially released by, or produced by, or disseminated by the public sector through the banking system, right? In other words, the Fed, working in conjunction with the banking system, is distributing a monetized form of the full faith and credit of the United States. Now, if that's correct, then you can think of the financial system, or at least the banking system. I'll get to the broader financial system in just a moment. But if that's correct, then you can think of the banking system as a sort of franchise arrangement, right? The public, operating through its central bank, is a sort of franchisor. And what it's essentially doing is entering into franchise arrangements with private franchisee institutions, pursuant to which they disseminate this public resource, the monetized full faith and credit of the United States. The bank is McDonald's, in a sense, right? Or it's a McDonald's branch. And I mean, I hate to mention poison food in this connection, but you get the idea, right? So that's the key, that's the first point, right? The banking system is a kind of public-private franchise. The next point, and I'm just about to wrap up, is if you look at the rest of the financial system, it turns out that the remainder of the financial system essentially has the same property. As the rest of the financial system is a kind of further outward radiation of this essential franchise arrangement. And the way you can see this, and this is all written up in great detail with all sorts of maniacal mad scientist diagrams and so forth, and some papers that Dan can, I guess, share with you guys if you don't have them already. Essentially, the way it works is the same kind of accommodation and monetization mechanism that we find in the banking system with the central bank occupying the central role can also be found throughout the financial markets in the so-called shadow banking system. If you look at the way repo transactions work, and if you look at the way repo is being changed now as a result of reforms brought in by the Dodd-Frank Act, you'll see that the repo system is essentially replicating the banking system in its fundamental operation as a sort of method or a mechanism pursuant to which the monetized full faith and credit of the United States is disseminated. If you look at the derivatives markets, and the central clearing that's coming to them under Dodd-Frank, and the role that the Fed is going to play there, essentially the same story. And if you look at money market funds, and if you look at the commercial paper markets, again, essentially the same story is occurring. And note that this is all quite apart from the earlier mentioned critical role that US Treasury securities play as a kind of base money within the financial markets more broadly. So we think that the best interpretation of the system that we have, a kind of Dworkinian best lights interpretation of the arrangements that we actually have and how they function, is this sort of franchise interpretation. We think of the financial system as a kind of public-private franchise arrangement. And the problem that occurred in the lead up to 2008 is essentially a problem of franchisor absenteeism. Right? The public has sort of lost sight of this particular role, notwithstanding the fact that it's kind of hidden in plain sight, that it's right there to see. All you've got to do is make an empirical examination of how bank transacting actually happens, and then look again with a greater degree of intensity, perhaps, at how transacting occurs in the shadow banking markets. Okay. Now, the normative consequence of this, and I'm just about to hand it over to Sally, a normative consequence of this, we believe, is that it's critical for the public sector to play a much more active role in its capacity as franchisor. Because if it doesn't, there's an inherent tendency for the franchisee institutions, the private institutions that partly constitute the system, to overextend credit during so-called boom times, which of course is the way you get an asset price bubble, and of course to underextend credit after a bust. And we also think that one reason for that tendency to sort of overextend or underextend credit is because the private franchisee institutions also have a very strong incentive to misallocate credit owing to certain collective action problems that afflict all decentralized markets, all decentralized market economies, that private actors themselves can't solve and that you require exercises of collective agency to solve. And so our view then is that there's a critical allocation task, a critical credit allocation task that the franchisor, the public sector side of the arrangement has to play, and that playing that allocative or that allocatory task correctly is an indispensable prerequisite to performing the equally important credit modulatory task, modulating credit aggregates. And so the final stage of our project is essentially to sort of design new institutions that can sort of perform that role more fully and more effectively, thereby enabling the public sector to play that more active, allocated, and modulatory role. It's design institutions that enable it to do that after we've sort of argued for them. So we've made these sort of theoretical claims on the one hand about the nature of the financial system. We also do a bit of varying of the orthodox account of public goods to sort of real, in order to make clear that the category of public goods is a little bit more capacious than economic orthodoxy has realized. And then we design institutions that are meant to do that. And now I'll hand it over to Sally to sort of talk about that sort of side of the project.
Thank you. Then, would you rather have people get the sushi?
Well, David just texted. Let me. I think you should go. I'm not. I think that they delivered to the wrong building. So, yeah.
Yeah. I hate talking to you while I'm just long. So. I also have to stand up a bit because of this fine device kind of work. Also, it makes me look taller, which is a big issue for me, being a friend and co-worker. So, you know, perhaps. Everything that Bob said is absolutely correct, right? But perhaps just to make the point a little bit more stark for you guys. You know, I'm sure that a lot of you, whenever you took any classes, be it economics or financial regulation or banking law or whatever it is, right, crack open any book, corporate finance, whatnot, and the first thing that you will see there is this notion that, oh, what is financial system about? What are the functions of the financial system? And then you see and read that metaphor of financial intermediation, right? Those are the words that are constantly used. There are savers of funds, there are users of funds, surplus units, and deficit units. And then, from that point on, there is a beautiful edifice of what the financial system is like. And that edifice is typically the silos. So, you know, turns out that, you know, banking is not the only way to intermediate those funds to facilitate investment. And how do you facilitate investment? You basically reduce the risks faced by the surplus units in, you know, transferring their funds to somebody else. But then there is another silo where there are capital markets, and they disintermediate the banks because they offer an alternative vehicle for that extra money, for the investment to happen from one private group of actors to another private group or public group of actors. Because the government in that picture is just like any other deficit unit. The government does not generate. The government needs to borrow. The government needs to compete with other private users of those funds for the privilege of borrowing from private investors. And from that point on, what happens is that there is a very easy step. It's imperceptible. Because once you buy into that picture of the world, then clearly it becomes easy to buy, for example, certain policy prescriptions. Like, for example, yeah, we should regulate banks and we should regulate risks in the financial system. However, we have to be mindful of unintended consequences, because those unintended consequences may actually frighten the providers of the investors away from certain things. And they will start moving from the regulated silo, that is the banking silo, into unregulated silo, which could be capital markets, or it could be shadow banking, or, I don't know, Bitcoin and all of that other stuff, right? So we should really be mindful about what the state does. And another thing is, like, you always have to be careful about how much the state really knows about finance. Because after all, the state is an outsider to the financial system, right? So from that point on, you're basically stuck in a particular vicious circle. You need to regulate, except every time you try to regulate, there is a whole host of completely legitimate concerns that essentially tell you, do not regulate, right? And then we move in circles and circles. And that's where Bob and I have realized that, you know, instead of fighting a million of disparate battles about, you know, is this level of bank capital enough, or is that level enough, should we regulate derivatives this way, that way, we should actually hit at the very bottom, you know, bottom line. We should hit at the master narrative. And hitting at the master narrative, my friends, turns out to be the hardest thing of all. Because that narrative is so deeply seated in everybody's consciousness. Everybody who is participating in the discussion that we're having, that dislodging what people routinely think about how finance works becomes extremely, extremely difficult. However, the funniest thing is that the economists a lot of economists who understand money and banking and who work at central banks have already done a lot of the groundwork for us. Except nobody has ever connected the dots when the economists explain how banks create financing out of what the economists say, out of thin air, out of whole cloth. Private banks actually generate investment in the economy because they generate new, not previously existing, purchasing power when they make loans. And when they make loans, they automatically also make corresponding deposits. In other words, that whole notion of the savers of funds coming to the bank with their hard-earned dollars, depositing those dollars, and then the bank wisely using those dollars to finance somebody else's enterprise, it's nonsense. And it's nonsense not because we, two crazy lefty lawyers, say that. It's because those economists who actually know money and banking work in central banks say it. Except when they say it, everybody else, of course, nods their heads and just turns around and continues with a completely flawed, you know, assumption of some kind of financial implementation, nevertheless being the master narrative. So what we're doing here is just connecting the dots and then making the logical step away from those descriptive notions, right, to the normative part. And the normative part is, look, we can never solve the problem of the financial, all the dysfunctions in the financial system that we continue to have. And we can argue till we turn blue. Is it contagion or is it connected? Is it fake or is it shadow banking? Is the capital Basel III better than Basel II? Yeah, we've done that. And, you know, we're still in the midst of those things. But the key questions that need to be answered is, like, how does the financial system relate to the rest of the economy and ultimately to the polity? In other words, we have to have a narrative that offers us a systemic and dynamic view of what we are doing with the money. Why do we care about whether or not banks are safe, right? We only care about whether or not banks are safe because we want those banks to do their job. First, we have to define what their job is. And the second step that we need to take is that when we try to develop that systemic and dynamic view of finance as part of society, the economy and the broader society, we can never ignore the role of the state, the role of the sovereign, the role of us collectively as the sovereign public behind it. We can never pretend that the sovereign public is just, you know, some kind of policeman that creates the rules or janitor that sweeps up, you know, after everybody binge on the punch, yeah, exactly. Or, you know, to use one of your esteemed professor's metaphor, a fire department that comes in and puts out the fires, right? It's not just that. The government, the public, have to be recognized for what they really are. They are actually the, you know, integral, the most important participant in the creation of that new purchasing power by all these private banks that then gets replicated and amplified by all these capital markets participants and shadow banks and Bitcoin exchanges and what have you. The government and the public, we are the government, essentially, right? I don't mean the government by, you know, saying it's a particular institution that we all know from empirical knowledge, but the sort of the idea of the sovereign public acting through certain public instrumentalities, right? Think of it as, the ultimate backer of every single financial claim that moves inside that beautifully complex and very fast moving and increasingly global financial system. Without that backer, that entire enterprise, that entire beautiful system of private ordering is untethered. It doesn't have it doesn't have the hope to go to. So one metaphor that I use in my class when I explain to my students what I mean is that, for example, imagine that you are a person who comes, for example, to this country from a place where you've never seen modern theater. You don't know what theater is like. And they take you to a theater and you watch a Shakespearean play unfold in front of you. And you enthralled and it's beautiful and it's great. Right? And afterwards, somebody asks you, so what is theater? Define me. For me, what a theater is, and you tell them the theater is when a bunch of people are standing on the scene and they fall in love and they hate each other and they betray each other and they cry and they laugh, and in the end, you know, the love triumphs, or maybe not, everybody dies, right? So, are you describing theater correctly? or is that incorrect? Of course it is correct, right? Because that's what you see. But is it complete? It's incorrect in the sense of being incomplete. Because what you don't see is what happens behind that curtain, right? So behind the scene, you have the playwright, you have the director, you have the masters, the masterminds who put that story in front of you. But if you only watch and focus on what's happening on the stage and you don't understand what drives these happenings, you will never be able to explain to me what the theater is truly, right? And this is what we're trying to do with our kind of concept of the finance franchise as the proper metaphor for the financial system and the role of the state as the franchisor, as that director and the playwright behind the scene that makes the beautiful and complex game that unfolds in front of you and entertains you and enthralls you, makes you cry, makes you scream, right, to happen. And so to operationalize that notion, then we take the next step. And we develop the conceptual framework for understanding how the proper relationship should be recalibrated between the state and the private actors in the financial system and the rest of the real economy. And the framework that we develop for it, we call it the development of finance state. It's sort of a riff on these theories of developmental state that maybe some of you who did some political science or sociology are familiar with. But it's sort of the notion of the state that uses the modalities of private financial markets consciously and specifically to promote the flow of financial resources, right, into the real economy for the purpose of actually generating sustainable socioeconomic development of the entire country, or maybe whatever the proper unit is, right? And so we go with it, and we try to look at how that development of finance actually already exists in this country, of the great free market ideology, like we all know that, you know, it's all about private ordering, right? But even in this country, the central bank that we have, the Federal Reserve, right, every day it goes out, the Federal Reserve Bank of New York goes out every morning into the market and purchases U.S. treasuries and sells U.S. treasuries, right? And it enters into repurchase transactions with a variety of banks for the purposes of affecting the interest rates, right, in the country. What is that? Is that a pure governmental function, as we understand? Of course not. It's a market function. It's a function of a market maker, a dealer in a particular financial instrument. We have Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, for example, maintaining secondary markets by making those markets secondary markets and providing liquidity to the private mortgage lenders, for example, right? What is that? Is that purely governmental, or is it sort of quasi-governmental? Is it market? It's a market function, right? So we go through the taxonomy of these functions as they already are being performed, and then we take it one step further. Because once you change the narrative, and once you change the appreciation of what the government already does in financial markets, then you can envision much bolder and bigger ways for the government to enter that space. And we'll be happy to answer any more specific questions that you might have curiosity about what that is.
So I have two basic questions just to wrap my mind around this. The first one, for some context, I studied law in Panama, and we use the dollar in Panama. So I'm very curious about this idea of a claim against the Federal Reserve, because beforehand that claim would make sense in something tangible such as gold or silver. But with fiat currency, me as a Panamanian, I bring my dollar over from Panama. What's my claim, and what is my standing to make that claim as someone who's not from the US, if the system is based on the Federal Reserve? And then the other quick question.
Why don't we take it one at a time?
Sorry. Yeah.
So there are basically, I think, two answers to that question, right? Or there are sort of two respects in which you can view the money that's issued by the central bank as a sort of claim. The first, the one that's often mentioned by so-called modern money theorists, is that, well, at the very least, the same government that issues the currency has to recognize it in payment of tax obligations, right? So in that sense, it's a liability of the government. There's another, a broader way in which you can say the same thing, which is to say that insofar as there are legal tender laws that basically require people to accept the nation's currency in payment of other obligations as well, even beyond tax liabilities, then there too you've got a kind of claim, right? And that's the sense in which I think it's best to view dollars as concerned. The question of dollarization, say, in Latin America, which of course is a common raises a few complications, but not really serious or terribly sort of vitiating complications. The one sense in which things change a bit when you dollarize in that way is that, of course, the Panamanian government in this case has effectively relinquished its right to issue the domestic currency or to control the supply of it, right? And you could sort of say the same thing with respect to Greece in relation to the euro, right? That basically, if you don't have a truly sovereign currency that you yourself are issuing, you've in effect tied at least one hand behind your back when it comes to modulating how much of it is out there. But that doesn't change the essential liability nature of the currency. If Panama says the dollar is our currency, and Panama has legal tender laws that say that, all right, this is going to be recognized by everybody in payment of debts or payment for various purchases, and at the same time, the Panamanian government also says we undertake to recognize payments of tax liabilities in dollars, then you've got exactly the same liability arrangement there as you have here in the U.S. where the dollar is actually issued by the sovereign power.
Thank you. And the other quick question was just, if the franchisees got it wrong, and we the people are the government, which makes us the franchisor,
right.
We're also, there's this mixing of we the people were the franchisees,
right.
But then in aggregate, we're also the franchisors.
Right.
So these finance people who've been making money if they got it wrong, why is someone looking at it removed from the ivory tower going to get it right?
What a great question. Yeah, so this is where we sort of ran out of time and weren't able to elaborate at length on the central role played by certain kinds of collective action problem in a disaggregated market economy, right? But so we have this idea that basically disaggregated markets, especially financial markets, are rife with a particular kind of collective action problem that we call a recursive collective action problem. So the basic idea is this. Let's take the case of consumer price inflation as a sort of familiar and simple example. If I go to the store today and a loaf of bread costs $2, and if I have reason to think that tomorrow it's going to cost $2.25, and on Saturday or on Sunday it's going to cost $2.50, it's individually rational for me to go out and buy the bread now rather than later, right? Because it's going to be more expensive later. But each of you, of course, each of us in our individual capacities act on the same calculation, right? We all do what's individually rational. But then as we all do this, as we all sort of descend on the market tomorrow or today to go ahead and buy the bread now rather than later, we actually exacerbate the very problem that has occasioned our foreshortening our purchasing horizons in the first place. That's to say that we cause the inflation rate to accelerate even further, right? So it's a collective action problem in that sense. It's a sense in which multiple individually rational decisions aggregate into a collectively irrational, if not calamitous outcome. Now, remember, the inflation example is just one very simple, intuitively, easily tractable example. But you can find precisely the same phenomenon, the same basic structure all across the markets, and especially the financial markets. Think of an asset price inflation, for example, like housing. It's essentially the same story, except that it's made even worse because the credit aggregates that were released in order to enable people to buy homes, of course, led even more purchasing activity to take place. So in the housing markets in the lead up to 2007, 2006 is when it basically stopped, in the summer of 2006. Basically, in those markets, you didn't really have an inflation, you had a hyperinflation, right? Same story with a depression or a debt deflation that follows a crash, right? It's individually rational for companies to lay off workers because their revenues have declined, their profits have declined. But as they lay off workers, purchasing power in the aggregate declines further. That means even less purchasing is done. That means even more people have to be laid off. The collective action piece of this story is kind of obvious when you think about it. The recursion element comes in because you basically have multiple rounds. It's a kind of iterated collective action problem, with each round, in effect, reacting to the predecessor round. Now, the key point to make here is that if you have a certain set of markets where recursive collective action problems of this kind are rife and pervasive, there's only one way to solve them, right? You solve a collective action problem through an exercise of collective agency. And we used to have a name, a more colloquial name for a collective agent. We called it a government, right? Or a government instrumentality. In effect, what we have to do is act collectively through particular instrumentalities to address those particular problems. That's the way you prevent from getting things wrong. So we never claim, we never say, I mean, I'm sure you could find plenty of people who are just crazy or idiotic or ignorant out there in the financial markets in the lead up to 2008. And there are lots of people, doubtless, who are venal and indeed criminal. But the crucial point from our point of view is you don't have to assume any of that to explain what happened. Even if everybody out in the markets in the lead up to 2008 was a genius and an angel, The same bloody thing could have happened. And that's the sense in which they, quote unquote, get it wrong. They don't get it wrong necessarily because individually they're ignorant or stupid or venal, although plenty of them doubtless are. They get it wrong because they're disaggregated and we're not acting collectively with respect to collective action problems, right? And that's what's necessary. It's fine to act individually with respect to a non-collective action problem, but you have to have an exercise of collective agency to do that. And that's where the sort of instrumentalities that we're trying to develop sort of come into the story, and where the additional roles of existing instrumentalities that we think ought to be pursued come into it as well.
Thank you. It's kind of I'm curious, kind of following up on that question that I answered in terms of who is the public and who should speak and be regulating or deciding what these priorities are? Do you envision laying the same way that we corn off on an independent central bank because we think good or bad reasons, right? So like who, to what extent do you think that the shepherd of the system should be like democratically accountable, like more independent? Like what does that look like in the way that it works?
So we ultimately, I mean, obviously the public as a whole is ultimately, I'll hand it over here. I mean, the public as a whole obviously is going to be the ultimate decider. But there are various degrees of insulation from immediate democratic decision-making that seem apt in some cases and inapt in other cases, right? So when it comes to making tax policy, it seems to make sense to have the legislators themselves, our more direct representatives, making tax policy. When it comes to making decisions in legal cases and controversies, it doesn't make sense to do that. We don't think it's a good idea to have a plebiscite to decide whether O.J. Simpson is guilty or to decide whether, you know, General Flynn is guilty. It seems to us that that's something for, you know, a sort of specialized and partly insulated court to do. Likewise, when it comes to the central bank's role in determining interest rates or money supplies, there ought to be some degree of insulation, even if you have ultimate accountability. The sorts of things we talk about, the sorts of proposals we make, involve proposals at various levels of insulation in that way. We actually think that some things, some allocative decisions that are often thought of as pure fiscal policy matters, which legislators ought to do, we actually think some of those should be more insulated, and particularly decisions with respect to what we call systemically significant prices. An interest rate is one systemically significant price, but if you think about it, and we write about this at length in the papers, there are lots of other ones too, right? That basically systemically significant price is one that enters into other prices and accordingly has a pervasive effect across markets. We think that more than the interest rate is a systemically significant price, and we accordingly think that something with a central bank-like kind of independence or insulation ought to be determining some of those prices, or at least confining their fluctuations with the relatively narrow bands ought to be occurring as well.
Yeah, so this is, you know, this is an incredibly important and very, very complicated question. But think about it, it's sort of philosophically, it's impossible to get out of that puzzle, no matter what we do, unless we just live as, you know, atomized human beings, not part of the society, right? Because you know, each one of us has certain individual private interests, right? We have to feed ourselves and our families and all. But then sometimes some of us find ourselves in a position of some kind of public responsibility, right? And suddenly we have to, you know, for example, if I become, I cannot be a president of this country, but let's imagine if I were, right? And if I had my private interests, some private businesses I had, I would have to kind of, you know, divide my brain and my loyalties and pledge allegiance to this polity, right? That when I act, when I'm wearing this hat, the presidential hat, I will act as if I'm not an individual human being with private needs and my own family and my own desire to make my children happy and rich and happier and richer than other people's children, right? But somehow I will embody the general will, right? And we accept that because we have no other solution to that fundamental problem, right? So the same kind of thinking should apply to when we think about institutions, public instrumentalities, specific institutions, right? Because we are now familiar with certain tasks that certain institutions, like for example, we know that central bank targets inflation, right, by manipulating interest rates, for example, or targets unemployment or not. And we are sort of, some of us are less comfortable with that, some, but in general, we're already comfortable with that, right? But as soon as we kind of start imagining the same instrumentality taking a larger role in the private markets, right, we get uncomfortable, because then we were, oh, what about accountability? Well, what about accountability, right? How do you hold an individual accountable for the promise of acting on behalf of everybody else, right? So part of that, the critical part of it, is the mandate. So when you give that me as an individual the mandate to be the president of this country, suddenly by accepting that mandate, I am basically pledging my ability to do so. So what if you change the mandate of the Federal Reserve, expand that mandate from just, keep consumer prices stable, or whatnot, and make it broader, saying, stability of all systemically significant prices, not just consumer prices. Suddenly you give that instrumentality a different mandate, and that will change the way they will have to, formulate their actions. And it will also give us the right to create accountability mechanisms that will check for the efficacy of that kind of stuff. So that's just a very generic answer to that, but there is never perfect solution. We just have to try.
I have a question.
Sure.
So, one of the things that Morgan Ricks talks about is money as sort of an issue of sovereignty and money creation as a sovereign responsibility. And it seems like there are obviously some parallels with your work. But I'm wondering if your concern about sort of what Morgan Ricks would call the unauthorized creation of money, and if you're concerned about the privileged access to money creation through the banking core is somewhat different than his is, or if you could just talk about the connection between the two.
So we're very good friends with Morgan, and we trade papers a lot, and we respect and admire him greatly. But we think his work and our work are, in a sense, quite mutually complementary. And the easiest way to categorize, or to sort of characterize, I think, the distinction on the one hand and the commonality on the other, is to say that Morgan's focus is on the liability side of the balance sheet of any financial institution or intermediary. So the money claims he talks about are in the nature, if we're talking about a bank, they're deposit claims. If it's a shadow bank, it's, of course, the repo loan. But it's always on the liability side of the balance sheet. Our focus is much more on the asset side of the balance sheet. In other words, we're much more concerned with the credit generative properties of financial institutions' operations, starting with the banking core, but then radiating outward. Now, what this leads to, on the one hand, it leads to a lot of complementarities when it comes to our distinct proposals, but it does lead to one important contrast that we tend to think we're quote-unquote right on or right about. So the sense in which there are complementarities is obviously we both view the system as a kind of public-private partnership. We both view licensing of some sort, we think of as a franchise license, as being essential to the proper functioning of the system. And indeed, we actually think that this is essentially what we're talking about when we talk about franchise or absenteeism. So as far as all of that goes, we and Morgan are on exactly the same page. But we are nevertheless on distinct sides of the page, as it were. He's on one side of the balance sheet, we're on the other. I think the difference with us is by focusing mainly on the liability, and maybe exclusively on the liability side of the balance sheet, that leads Morgan to focus on one particular problem as what he thinks of as the problem of financial regulation, and that's, of course, panic proofing. He's most concerned about the so-called maturity mismatch problem and the possibility, or the constantly endemic possibility, of runs on particular financial institutions that have generated these short-term money claims. Obviously, that's important. We think that's pretty important as well. But we think at least as important, and probably, if we were really, push came to shove, I think I would at least be willing to say even more important, is what happens on the asset side of the balance sheet, because that's where macro credit aggregates economy-wide are determined, and that's where, in consequence, you get over-generation of credit in some cases, under-generation of credit in other cases, and massive misallocation of credit as well. And panics are simply, a panic is simply what happens when you have all of that stuff happening to the point where it's reached the breaking point. And once it reached the breaking point, the crash just is the panic. But you can't panic-proof, in our view, without looking to see the process, the dynamics pursuant to which the excessive hypergrowth of credit aggregates, which is itself partly a function of the type or misallocation of credit agents without figuring out how that happens and figuring out what to do to stop that from happening. In our view, take care of that, and the panic proofing problem takes care of itself. So we think that Morgan's focus ought to be the secondary focus. And indeed, you might not even have to do anything about it if you do a worsening. He, of course, says something that sounds almost like the contrary. Take care of panic proofing and not everything else to solve. We think that's probably not quite right. Or if it's right, it's just another way of saying what we're saying.
I was really compelled by the master narrative piece of your talk about that whole kind of, have you thought about kind of doing like a Wizard of Oz or like the modern thing that like kind of like I guess like some kind of, because you brought up a play as like some kind of new narrative or new metaphor for like the average person to be able to like understand conceptually the way the system works.
That's the next step. Okay, give us some time.
I was just curious.
We actually are thinking about that, because what we've been doing was we started writing a series of articles, and actually the finance franchise, the metaphor, the master narrative article came kind of toward the end of the process, because we gradually arrived at the understanding ourselves, and we're not yet 100% sure with respect to every single wrinkle, because there are many wrinkles, right? But our goal now is to actually step back a little bit and think about how to bring all these different bits and pieces together and think about a better metaphor that would be more intuitively understandable to an average person. The danger here is that we have to speak to the average person on the street, right? But we also have to speak to our colleagues in the financial academic community and the industry. And with them, it's very difficult because they have that beautiful theoretically established, you know, metaphor of financial intermediation. And if we come out and start talking in terms of fire department and janitorial services, then they will just dismiss us. That's yet another lefty group that they don't know anything, right? So we have to kind of be careful.
One quick follow-up, by the way, just because you mentioned the Wizard of Oz. Some people in the room might know that was actually itself a money story. Right? The Yellow Brick Road was supposedly the gold standard, and as they said to Frank Baum, who's one of the silverists and bimetallists who wanted to grow the money supply by having silver also recognized as a money base back in the late 19th century. So it's a nice example in this context in particular.
Yeah, I also like to the brain, the heart, and the courage, right?
Yeah.
And, you know, if you think about it, the franchise of we, all together, we need to reclaim all of those qualities, right, in the realm of finance in order to make sure that the future of this country is actually what it deserves to be. Otherwise, we will keep having not only economic dysfunctions, but political dysfunctions as well, right, as we all know now. So maybe there is something to the Wizard of Oz. So we need to get your name. That is actually
I think this is probably our last one, but.
Can you clarify something? Because this is a very interesting and important conversation.
Thanks.
Are you looking at the asset side as a collective viewpoint or as an individual financial institution or both? Could you clarify that?
It's basically both, but we get to the micro via the macro, right? We start with the macro. We think, okay, look, credit aggregates economy-wide look to be misallocated at particular periods of time. We think that you can account for the misallocations in significant part by reference to particular kinds of collective action problem that disaggregated individual market actors are subject to. But what that means in turn, then, is that in explaining how massive misallocation occurs at the macro level, and how that can then feed into massive undermodulation or overextension of credit. But in order to sort of fully understand how that happens, the collective action problem explanation gets you back down to the micro. That gets you down to what are the individual incentives that the private actors, including privately owned financial institutions, face and act upon, usually rationally, in such manner as all aggregates into a massive macro misallocation and hence macro over extension or under modulation problem. Is that responsive?
It is, but there's another piece of that. If you bring it down to how the government should act,
right?
making the case. This is not a political question.
Sure, sure.
But it's an important financial question. Are you making a case for government action to look at preemptively individual financial institutions, because we have, these are run by people and not machines, and they all have their own interests to deal with and values that come to them.
Yeah. So two answers to that, right? On the one hand, one way of looking, one piece of the whole menu of proposals that we make, you can think of as a kind of enhanced, even a kind of on steroids form of macroprudential regulation. Note that the way that macroprudential regulation works is by the use of microprudential tools. They're the same old tools, but we simply use them with a new object in mind. So you use the traditional microprudential tools in a macroprudential way. And in that sense, you actually are structuring the incentives up. You're actually, you know, requiring things of and prohibiting things from particular individual actors. And that's a piece of what we do. But another piece that I think is more radical, much bigger, is we actually are advocating the creation of a new institution we're calling the National Investment Authority. You can think of it as a kind of an update and upgrade of the old Reconstruction Finance Corporation, or RFC, which in the 30s and 40s was by far the largest financial institution in the world, whose balance sheet dwarfed that of all Wall Street combined, affirmatively making certain kinds of public investment that we think are undermade now, not only for traditional, not only owing to the traditional public goods type problem, which is a sort of variation on the collective action problem, but for other reasons as well that basically require us to develop the theory of public goods and extend it a bit and broaden it out. So the idea here is we actually have direct public investment in certain areas that are underinvested in by private actors, again, for perfectly individually rational reasons. And this has sort of two wonderful effects, right? One is you get more of this investment that you need into these primary markets or into actual real economic growth or real economic progress, rather than the speculation on secondary markets by private individual actors, which again can be rational given a backdrop of the kind that we've had of late that's not sufficiently filled out by the public sector. And it also offers a new asset class, because these particular projects are going to issue particular kinds of security, a new asset class for investors who are actually looking for something other than kind of silly secondary market speculative trade, something actually to invest in that has a bit of yield, maybe not as much yield as a kind of a high-risk trade on the derivatives market, but more yield than a treasury security, for example. And there we actually bring the public and the private in together. The key idea is it's sort of like a private equity fund, but in this case, it's the public sector that does the directing. The private sector supplies some of the funding, although not all of it by any stretch.
All right, I think that we're just about out of time, so please, everyone, join me in thanking Professor.